It is really a great privilege and an honor to be appearing here in conversation with Elizabeth Nunez. I've really been fortunate to have worked with her over the years now on four books that Akashic Books has published with her. Before inviting Elizabeth up here, I just want to follow on a couple of things that John referenced a moment ago. You know, in this city, I can think of few comparable cultural institutions to the center and the work that's being done here. You know, this really is a unique space both for readers and for writers as well. Really, just the scope of programming that takes place here. Some of the tremendous names, some of the talent, you know, across multiple genres and disciplines. The Crime Fiction Academy, for example, that is hosted here is really just first class. And I encourage everyone to look at the programming, consider joining the library or making a donation, or at the very least purchasing a book, hopefully one of Elizabeth's, but if not, supporting some of the other really key integral endeavors that the center puts on. So thank you to John, Doreen, Kristen, Gwen, everyone involved in the center for all that they do. So rather than regurgitating Elizabeth's biography, I'll just share a couple of words about what I find to be really exceptional and unique about her and her approach to her craft. I think, Elizabeth is really set apart from a lot of writers in that she is ultimately a teacher. And, that position of being sort of on both sides of the publishing process as both an author and as a teacher and as a student of writing, a dedicated student of writing, I think gives her a really unique perspective on her craft. And it's so rare to see an author with the ability to put forth such a laser sharp insight on the world around her. And I'm going to invite Elizabeth up now to read a short passage from her brand new novel, Even in Paradise, that is just published this month. And then we'll open it up for a conversation that we'll invite everyone else to take part in. So without further ado, Elizabeth Nunez will read from Even in Paradise. Please everyone join me in welcoming her up.
Thank you, all of you, for being here. I see such good friends, people who have known for a while. You know who you are, and I'm seeing you. Thank you for being here. I have a special connection with the center. I was once a board member here, so I know the great work you do. And I'm sorry Noreen is here, but I want to thank her very much for hosting me today. So without further ado. This novel is set in the Caribbean. All the characters are Caribbean characters, meaning that all of them, they may be different ethnic groups, but they have been in the Caribbean for generations. The person I'm going to read about, Peter Duxwood, is an Anglo-Caribbean. But if you remember in Jean Rhys, White Sagasso's Cassie, Rochester looks at Antoinette and says, "Of English blood she may be, but she's neither English nor European, you know." And then you're going to meet, well, we can talk about who you're going to meet afterwards. But the situation here right now is an engagement. Peter Duxwood's eldest daughter, I almost want to say Conrail, but it's not, Glynis, is about to get engaged. And they are in Barbados. It was late afternoon, and the sky blazed bright with the fiery colors of the dying day. The sun, a big glittering round ball, fanning out a palette of oranges and reds that dissolved into shades of amber and turmeric, and casting a tunnel of golden light across the darkening sea. Peter Duxworth stood with his back to the railing, framed by all those sunset colors and the black silhouettes of the two lush green promontories that stood as sentinels guarding the cove at the bottom of the steep drop that fell from the edge of his house to the sea below. He had dressed for the occasion, shoes rather than sandals, and a white linen suit and pale blue shirt that matched his eyes. But I suspected he had had a drink or two before he filled his glass with champagne, for his eyes were glazed. When he spoke, however, there was no hint of the slurring I had heard the last time I saw him down several glasses of rum punch in quick succession. After he was sure we were all gathered on the deck, he fished out a silver spoon from his pocket, brushed back his slightly rumpled hair, and tapped the side of the tall champagne flute he was holding. Conversation around him died down. To my daughter Glynis on this happy occasion, he raised his glass towards Glynis. She beamed, the diamond on her finger glinted in the light of the descending sun. Albert, or his father, had spared no expense. And to my soon-to-be son-in-law, Duxford bowed to Albert, may you have a long and happy life together. There was a ricocheting chorus of hear, hear, more well wishes from Peter Duxford for his daughter's happiness. More praise for Albert, a man, he said, who had a solid head on his shoulders. Hear, hear resounded again across the deck. More champagne, Duxford called out to his housekeeper. I have something to say. Corinne grasped my hand and held it tightly. I could not tell if she was nervous about what her father might say, or if she was worried he would drink too much. I decided on the latter. It's only champagne, I whispered to her. He'll be okay. Duxworth waited until his housekeeper refilled our glasses, and then facing Glynis and Albert, who had their arms around each other's waist, he began. If you, Albert, and my daughter Glynis could have a smidgen of the happiness I had with my darling wife, his eyes turned misty, and he tipped the glass to his mouth, gulping down most of the champagne. Corinne made a half step toward him, and I put my hand on her wrist and brought her gently back to my side. If you could have, and again Duxford stopped, this time to brush away a tear that had settled in his right eye. Glynis, his eldest daughter, rushed over to him and wrapped her arms around his waist, pressing her face into his chest. No, no, Duxford disentangled himself from his eldest daughter's tight embrace. This is not a time for tears, it's a time for joy. Go back, Glynis. Glynis stumbled backward. Albert stuck out his hand to help her, but she stepped forward again. No, it was a command this time. Yet before we felt the shock of it, Duxford's voice softened. Let her go, Albert. Go next to your sister, Glynis. Stand next to Rebecca. Now everyone's eyes were glued to Duxford. No one moved. The only sounds were the rhythmic crashing of the waves onto the beach and the eerie screeching of seabirds wheeling across the sky, the setting sun lighting fire on their pale gray wings, and then the nosedive, the heads pointed downwards, beaks stabbing the unwitting fish in the blackening water. Strange, I thought, hungry so late in the darkening evening. Satisfied that he had our attention, Duxford's eyes fell first on Glynis and then on Rebecca. I have an announcement, a gift to make to my daughters. He looked over at Corinne, his youngest daughter. I could tell she was curious as I was, but apprehensive too. Her eyes were wide open, her head strained forward. Not to you, Corinne. Duxford shook his finger at her. Not right now. There'll be time for you. I want to make a gift to my newly married daughter and to... Rebecca would not let him finish. Oh, Daddy, her eyes sparkled, and she clapped her hands to her mouth. Oh, Daddy, you couldn't wait, Rebecca, but I could see why not. Duxford made a wide gesture with his hands towards Douglas's appearance. You have a fine son, he said, a fine young man. Mrs. Fairbanks mouthed thank you and sniffled into her handkerchief. And I mean to give you a gift too. Duxford was now looking at Glynis on the occasion of your engagement to Albert. Glynis bit down on her lips, her eyes glistened. A fine young man, your intended. You're too kind, Daddy, too kind. Glynis blew a kiss to her father. Duxford seemed not to have noticed the kiss. His head was tilted upward, and he was squinting, peering across the room as if he were searching for something or someone. I followed his line of vision, and saw he was looking directly at the white-haired Indian man in the charcoal gray suit who was leaning against the wall at the entrance of the deck. Well, I'm not like some besotted fathers we know, eh, Gopal? Duxford called after him. Gopal straightened up, raised his glass and gave a brief nod to Duxford. So I won't ask any of my daughters to swear how much they love me, huh? Gopal? Gopal laughed, a guffaw really, the sort of guarded acknowledgement an employee might give to his employer in case he had misinterpreted his meaning. Rebecca, though, wasted no time in reassuring her father. But we do love you, Daddy. You are the best father a daughter could have. Her face shone like the moonlight. Better than the best, said Glynis, glancing briefly at her sister, her brows contracting before she turned back to smile brightly at her father. I don't know what we would have done without you. After Mommy died, you were like mother and father all at once. So I love you twice as much. I love you with all the love I had for Mommy and all the love I've always had for you, two times more. And I, more than two times, Rebecca piped up. And I, three times more, no, four, five times more, Glynis said. Rebecca grinned, a childish chortle rising from the back of her throat. Yet there was something else I saw, something in her eyes, a cold determination that surprised me, for she had seemed to me ever willing to yield to her big sister. I, 100 times more, she declared. But Dennis exceeded her, and I more than life itself. More than life itself. Duxford smiled and puffed out his chest. See, he said to us who were witnesses to this extravagant display of filial love. See how my daughters fight over me. What could any of us say or do but applaud? Dennis and Rebecca ran to their father's side, each one embracing him, throwing her arms around his neck. See, they will strangle me with their love. Enough, enough, he said. But he was beaming, clearly thrilled with their public display of affection for him. Corin had not applauded. Her arms were crossed tightly up over her chest. She seemed frightened. And you? Duxford unwound his daughter's arms from his neck. What say you, my youngest daughter, my joy? Corin slid behind my back. Come forward. Duxford beckoned her. Let me see your lovely face. Hiding from your father, are you? But you see, he turned around to us. She's hurt. I didn't mean to leave you out, Corin. He stepped forward to her, cooing. You'll get your turn. I'll have something for you too. You don't have to, Daddy. Corin said, I need water. Thanks a lot, Aunt.
Hello, everybody.
And you, Duxford, unwound his daughter's arms from around his neck. What say you, my youngest daughter, my joy? I read that part. You'll get your turn. I'll have something for you, too. You don't have to, Daddy, Corin said softly, coming out to the open. You don't have to give me anything. She was standing in front of him now. But I do. You are the sweetest daughter a father can have. And I love you, Corin said. How much? Duxford asked. I think when Duxford asked that question, he was halfway jesting. He already knew he had much reason to assume Corin loved him deeply, but she hesitated. For a split second, she said nothing, and he became impatient, agitated. He had made sure of his certainty of his daughter's love for him, and now one, his youngest, the one he called his joy, the apple of his eye, was hesitating, making him wait for her answer, embarrassing him. How much, he repeated. Your sisters say they love me too, more than life itself, Glynis said. Do you love me more than life itself? I would do anything for you, Daddy. Corinne's bottom lip was trembling. Then tell me. Tell everyone here. Doxwood's voice grew gruffer, almost menacing. Tell them how much you love me. I had not thought Doxwood was drunk yet, but I was beginning to think he was losing control of his mind. His eyes shifted from one end of the deck to the other, settling on no one. There was a man who lived not far from my father's house who had eyes like that. Every afternoon he sat on the same park bench, digging his nails into the palms of his hand, as if the pain, I saw blood on his palm once, would stop him from doing something bad, something cruel. Henrietta said that his wife had left him. Whenever I passed by him, I would hear him mumbling, I thought you loved me. Duxford came closer to Corinne. He was shorter than she and had to raise himself on the tips of his toes to bring his face next to hers. How much? He asked her again, his breath upon hers. A deathly silence hung over the room. We were all uncomfortable, hoping for something or someone to break the tension building in front of us, and Glynis did. Just tell him, Corinne, she cried out. Tell him what he wants to hear. It's my engagement party. You're spoiling it. Or is it that you don't love Daddy as much as Rebecca and I do? Corinne looked into her father's eyes. I love you as much as a daughter can love her father, she murmured. Speak up, I didn't hear you clearly, Duxwood grumbled. My sisters have husbands, Rebecca does, and Glynis would have a husband too. They must love their husbands, and when I have a husband, I will love him too. I cannot give you all my love. I will have to share my love with my husband. Her response was reasonable. More than that, she had the authority of the Bible on her side. Genesis 2:24, a man shall leave his father and mother and shall cleave unto his wife. Even after her husband died, Ruth remained faithful to his people, walking away from his own. Duxford blinked and his face paled. And how much will I have? He asked, chastened, but so consumed by hubris he could not back down. An equal share, she said, half. Duxford grunted, twisted his head from side to side, and clamped his lips together as though to force his tongue to stay still in his mouth. Half. That was all she would give him. But he seemed to know Corinne well enough not to demand more. She might not lie like her sisters. She might embarrass him again, tell him the truth, and the truth was not what he wanted.
Just briefly contextualize this scene. It's such a pivotal moment in the novel. You know, so much hinges upon this, this altercation between father and youngest daughter. There's so much meaning imbued both in your novel and also in the Shakespeare original. Can you sort of just set the tone, both for people who might not be familiar with Lear, and also just to place our characters, where are they? What are the stakes for them? And you know, where does the narrative go from this point?
Well, I would just come back from the beginning. King Lear is not original to Shakespeare, of course. He copied the story from Holinshed's Chronicles, told a story 800 years BC about a king who decided, he was getting old, around 80 years old, and he decided to divest himself of his power and his possessions to his three daughters based on whose declaration of love for him is more persuasive. And when the youngest daughter answers, as my character answers, I can only give you half, then he disinherits her. What fascinated me about that play, Shakespeare's play, is the how the two older sisters are so evil. I mean, so I've read the play over and over again, and I know a lot of people focus on Lear, this is a crazy thing for him to do. He's fallen for flattery. This is what happens when you get old, you make those mistakes. But I was more interested in those two women, their three daughters, those two Ulu. They do everything under the sun. If you know the play, one poisons the other, one takes the other's boyfriend, one puts a contract on a husband's life. I mean, they are just terrible. And so I went to several productions. And if you ever happen to see Michael Pennington, that is, to me, the best production of Lear. It was actually in Brooklyn. I've seen bad productions, too. But I'm always fascinated by those two women. And you know, Jane Smiley had the same fascination, because in A Thousand Acres, that's who she focused on. And for her, the answer is, I don't know if I'm answering your question, I'm going off. The answer to that question for her is that the father sexually abused the eldest girl. So the eldest girl had this anger towards her father and passed it on. So that was her explanation for why they are so evil and so cruel. I can't find that explanation. I can't find that, I mean, far be it to me to say anything critical about Jane Smiley. She won a National Book Award and it was a big movie. Should happen to me. But it seems to me I was going in a different direction. It is that. Children want to be loved 100% by their parents, not 99%, 100%. And I have one child, so for mine is an easy one, 100%. But I often wondered what would happen if you had many children, and my parents had 11. So what happens? And just to give a little quick thing here, on one occasion I went back to Trinidad, and my father now is heading into his 90s. And one sister is in her early 50s and one is in her mid-50s. And the one in her mid-50s is furious because my father has a poster of my other sister in the breakfast room and is looking at that poster. And I can't understand. I said, but he likes to see that poster. Yes, but he only thinks about her. That's all he's doing is thinking. And she conspires with me to take the poster down. And I said, okay, I will put it in another room. And that's not enough. We must tear up the poster. That's the problem with those two girls. That is the problem with those two girls. It is one thing to, maybe love one child more than the other, but you can never say it. And Lear makes the mistake of always saying it. And when you read King Lear, you see that that's what the girls are saying all the time. The reason why he's so upset is because he loved her more than us. That's why he's going crazy like that. That's why he disinherited her. Because he loved her more than us, and it hurt him so much that she didn't say, I love you more than this moon and this stuff. So that was the angle I've taken in this novel.
So the Lear archetype is pretty well understood by most, but this isn't the first time you've gone to Shakespeare to reimagine some of these key momentous figures from the history of literature. I'm curious about the particular challenges and maybe some of the peculiarities you faced when trying to adapt the basic storyline to specifically a Caribbean context. And one important note about this novel is that it takes place variously across Barbados, Trinidad, and Jamaica. And in fact, one of the most interesting aspects of the novel to me is the sense that the reader has in understanding really the polyglot diversity of the islands and the sheer difficulty of trying to either, you know, easily account for them and the weight of history, the burden of history of the colonial past that is shared between the islands but manifests itself in very unique ways. I'm sure that, you know, posed some challenges for you when you were trying to, you know, Shakespeare is only one aspect, and I don't want to overstate the Shakespeare angle either, because you make this story your own,
mm-hmm.
and I'm curious about the Caribbeanness of your story. Can you speak to that a little bit?
Okay, so we'll forget the first part of your question, and I'll get to the second part. Leo Tolstoy famously, you want to know where I'm going with that? Huh? Well, Leo Tolstoy famously said that King Lear is the worst play ever written. And he had a lot of reasons for why it is the worst play that was ever written. And one of them is the anachronism of the play. He said the King Lear story occurred 800 years BC, and there was Shakespeare setting it in the Middle Ages. And of course, Shakespeare is very smart because he was dealing with the historical imagination of the people for whom he was writing. So he had his knights and the castles and so on. So I've kind of taken that same leap in saying that I will set mine in the Caribbean. And once you choose a place, a setting, then it's going to change a lot about your characters, what's going to happen. So, for example, my Peter Duxworth is English. It allows me to say a lot of stuff because the people who are of English descent in Trinidad, particularly, and in Barbados, and in Jamaica, same thing. They're Caribbean people, through and through. They're exactly like I am. They're speaking like me, they like the same food, they dance the same way. But they carry in them a secret that we know and they know. And you know what that secret is. How'd they get there? Right? So it's something we have to negotiate all the time. So that's, once I had a white character, in my novel, I have that to work with. Then I have another character who she's getting engaged to, Albert. And Albert is Lebanese, Trinidadian, Caribbean. There are a lot of Lebanese Caribbean people all through the islands. And there are generations there. My sister was married to one. And he died, unfortunately, but I'll tell you, at his funeral in St. Kitts, the Moko Jumbies moved from the back of the town all the way to the cemetery, all through the streets. On his grave, they did the drumming, they danced around him. You would think it was an African that they were burying, but they were burying a Caribbean man of Lebanese descent.
And in your novel, this Caribbean man of Lebanese descent happens to also be an Orthodox Maronite Christian, to further complicate matters. So, but this notion, though, of, you know, you have your Anglo protagonist in Duxworth, your Lear, and his youngest daughter Corinne is now, you know, she is now several generations removed from the brutality and criminality of her forefathers,
mm-hmm.
and I'm curious, and I don't know if there's a satisfying response to this, about the burden that rests on those who, you know, generationally have to carry this weight, this baggage. And this character Corinne, we see her at one point. She goes down and volunteers in Tivoli Gardens in Jamaica, which is a notoriously violent, extremely dangerous neighborhood in Kingston. And, you know, Corinne, fair-skinned, she has a photograph taken of her.
She's white.
She wears a dashiki and gets cornrows done by the family who she's tutoring. And this image ends up in the newspaper, and I'm curious this is a symbolic moment, and it's loaded with meaning. On one level, there's the, you know, potential for cultural appropriation, but she is making a well-intentioned gesture at trying to help somebody overcome their situation, and I'm wondering if you can expand upon this tension that your characters, your Anglo characters, have to grapple with.
I'm going to give a short answer, actually. I'm going to take you to Hamlet. Claudius is praying. He's, at this point, he's been outed. he knows that he killed Hamlet Sr. So he's praying to God for pardon, and he says these lines: "May one be pardoned and retain the offense." And if you know that soliloquy, it ends with Claudius's heels to the sky. So where has Claudius gone? Yeah. And why did he go there? May one be pardoned and retain the offense. And I think that's the question. It is a 21st century question. It's a question right now. That Ta-Nehisi Coates' book, Between the World and Me, is asking that question right now. They're asking Shakespeare's, that's why I love Shakespeare. That's the question they're asking right now. May one be pardoned and retain the offense. And Claudius, if you read that soliloquy, which is amazing, he says, yes, in this world, that's the way it is.
Is another way of looking at that question to wonder, and this is something we were discussing earlier today, what does it mean to really be from a place? What does it mean to be a real Trinidadian? Mm-hmm. Does it mean that you put pepper sauce on everything that you eat and dance with your hips? Does that make you a true Trinidadian? Or is it something else? And in fact, before you answer this question, I want to quickly just read a paragraph that one of your characters makes a reference to the writer George Lamming, and says that Lamming spends half the year teaching at a university in America. She tightened the locks on her braid and sighed, but I suppose he must. I suppose he must. I repeated her words silently to myself. We control our own government, our own economies, but we are yet to see the value of our artists. Lamming must go to America to make a living. His people claim to adore him. They are proud of him. He is their national hero, but they don't understand or want to understand that artists cannot live on air, the sun, and the sea. And I think I'm curious about your own relationship with Trinidad.
Yeah.
And, you know, again, if there's...
It's the problem. It's the problem of colonial, that's the difference, that is the heart of colonization. That's what it means to be colonized. It means that, and Frantz Fanon, of course, many, many years ago has put it really well, it's not just the colonization of your body, but it's the colonization of your mind. That does not disappear in one generation. That takes many, many generations. I can quote you Shakespeare, Chaucer, Wordsworth, Keats. Why? Because I was told to teach. I love it still, but that's what I memorized. There is a lack of appreciation. And I think it also has to do with geography, which, if you would permit me, Ibrahim, I want to say something about geography. I think geography is so important. And when I was writing this novel, I became clearer on how geography is important. When you're living on a little island where you can see the sea at any point, your look is always, regard is always outward. It's always over there. That's where life is, over there. That's where people are, over there. That's where the arts are. That's where the true literature is, over there. So when I come back home, oh, well, you're from here. What can you offer us? Did they say you were good? If they said you're good, then we'll say you're good. So it's very sad about great people like Lamming. So he spent, he's almost 95 now. But for many years, and it was very sad for me to see it, he would spend one semester at Brown University. Oh, why can't Barbados that has so much money? But Brown liked him, so he must be somebody. But just on the question of geography, you want to ask me the question? You asked me a question, the difference of the...
I guess another way to look at this is for looking at your own... looking at your own decision, your own, you know, your own career path, your own trajectory as a writer coming to the United States, do you feel like the opportunities that you have here are would have been totally absent in Trinidad? And if so, I mean, this seems like a major issue.
Absolutely, this is an amazing country.
But this is
an amazing country. I think it takes a, well, maybe for me, maybe you got it before I did, but it's taken a while to realize what freedom really means. And I don't think any place that freedom is simple things for me, like opening my door this morning because I wanted to pick up something and I have on my pajamas, I put my coat on, and nobody cares that I've done that. Nobody's looking at me. The most I could think of is, well, she picked up the garbage from there and went inside. I mean, that's putting it really shallow. But for a woman, if I want to see a movie, I pick up myself, I drive in my car, or I walk and I go to see the movie. Nobody's saying, what's this single woman sitting down here watching a movie? Is she looking for a man? You know, when I go to Trinidad, my sisters, when they leave the house, look impeccable. Their hair is well done, their face is done, I said, where are you going? I'm going to the grocery store. You should see me going to the grocery store. I look like, you know. Sometimes my son says to me, Mom, do people know you're a professor? And I'm like, I don't care, I'm going to buy something. So yeah, I couldn't live anywhere else. When my parents were alive, there was that tie always to them, and mostly to them and to the house and to the compound. But when they're no longer here, it doesn't matter to me.
So I want to dwell on this point a moment longer, but look at it through the prism of your narrator. And I think really one of the wonderful things, one of the many wonderful things about this novel is its voice. The narrator is a young man, Emil, whose family background, his mother, who died in his childhood, was a mixed European and Trinidadian origin.
And that's the important and French.
And French, yes. French particularly. So
you know why French? Guess. He is going to be connected to Corinne, the youngest of Duxwood's daughter. Do you recall?
So, right, we'll get to that. So, Emil, you know, he's a wide-eyed optimist, and he thinks that literature has the power to change the world. And he believes it, you know, truly believes it, and he actually sees his dreams. You know, he gets a job at a Jamaican newspaper and is offered an editorship of a literary supplement, and he sees that literature has the ability to move people to action. And I'm curious, you know, there's this sort of subplot in the novel, a tension between those who, you know, belong to the world of make-believe and the world of dreamers, mm-hmm. and those who think that those dreams have the power to change the world around them. Mm-hmm. And I'm wondering if you can discuss that a little bit more, and why you sort of chose to set up this opposition, and what sort of discoveries you make about it, and also, I'll read a sentence here. Another of your characters says, "It's story that moves people, not dry statistics. Stories, poems connect with people emotionally, make them feel. It's the heart, not the head, that causes people to take to the streets, that sets off revolution." And can you explain that a little bit?
Do you remember when Eric Garner was the police were freed. What is the word I'm wondering? Exonerated, right. And it was at night in New York City. And I was looking at CNN, and all the panelists, pundits were there. And they would, Addison Kufo said, oh my God, they're coming from the midtown Manhattan. Oh my God, they're coming from downtown Manhattan. Look, they're coming from the highway. They're coming. They were going bonkers. They couldn't understand why people were coming out there. And Jeffrey Toobin said something which got into my novel. He said, it's because of story. They knew these statistics all the time. That's what the panelists were saying. People knew these statistics. He said, but it didn't move them. The thing that moved them was the story of this man who was a father and children, whether you support him or not, but that's the story, a father and children, who had Lucy's, it's the story. In the story, they suddenly understood what it meant to be a black man in America. That story, that little incident, is what brought people out in the streets in so many numbers that the pundits couldn't figure it out. So that, to me, is the power of literature. The power of the novelist creates a world with characters that, if the novelist, I'm going to use she, is good enough. It's the world. The characters are believable, and she sets them. When you come to the end of my novel, I'm leaving you with some of the questions I couldn't answer. And hopefully you move on thinking about them in the way I had to think about them. And it's this identification that you have with the character that changes you. You don't necessarily identify with something you hear in the news or whatever you turn. But if you're reading a novel, and what the novelist's job is to do is to get you to care for the character emotionally, care what happens to that character, you're involved. So I think that, I don't think novels will ever die. I think the story will never die. I think we need it as much as we need air.
Well, this seems like a good transition to open it up and hear what everyone else has to say and have some conversation with Elizabeth. Any questions?
I just want to comment on what you were saying. Recently I heard a quote that I guess it was a writer or poet, anything can be born if it's told in a story.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I just wanted to ask you, how did you negotiate working with a classical text like King Lear and being able to put your own voice? How did you negotiate the classical story with your own vision?
Well, I think first you have to know the classic really well, in and out, over and over again. I mean, for me, both for this novel and for Prospero's Daughter, I spent a year just writing notes, or if not more. And then you're not doing the whole play, I'm just doing a certain, there are many more things in that play. And you just keep, until you own it. And then what I say to my students is that there's a passion you have that you bring to the story. There's something you yourself, as the writer, wants to explore. You want to explore this through the class. And Shakespeare's a good way to start. Shakespeare teaches me so much. You want to say something? I can see her mouth going like this. I want to say something.
Obviously, Shakespeare's a huge impact on your mind and your thinking. Who else? What other classics of literature? It sounds like Shakespeare might be the biggest one. But what are other works that authors and works that are have had a seminal impact on you?
Let me say, I don't like Shakespeare for probably the reasons people, aesthetic kind of scholarly reasons that people have. I like him because he's a great plotter. Great plotting and pacing. You read Shakespeare, first act, scene one, you got the problem. The father wants to give away his stuff. The witches are coming around giving some predictions. Hamlet has come home and his father is missing and his mother has married his brother. You know the problem right away. So he teaches me about how to write a novel, how you do that. But you asked me about my other people. I hate to say it, but my head is really in the old, late 19th century, early 20th century writing. I mean, I read Jane Austen from beginning to end over and over. I've just finished my third reading of George Eliot's Middlemarch, which I absolutely adore. There are books I read Anna Karenina over and over again. I read these books, maybe it's my age or whatever, maybe growing up on an island, maybe being in a colonial place, I can identify. But more contemporary writers, I like J.M. Coetzee very much. I like McEwen, Not Everything by McEwen. The novel that I just love, but not everything by him, is The Sea by John Banville. Oh, I think that book is just an exquisite novel. Very small. I love Beloved. That's a novel I read over and over again. I think she's amazing with that novel. That's it. But I have an old head, I have to say. I know, I teach creative writing. My students write these stories, and I could talk about the craft, but what they're writing, I said, my God, I didn't know. The rest of the class, oh yeah, they're talking about this, you know. I don't know, he's talking about some kind of games. It's a parody on some kind of game. What game?
There was a question in the back.
It's a sort of broad question, and maybe not very acute, but I just wonder, what makes a story, in your opinion, and people have different answers, what makes a story a Caribbean story? Not just it being placed on an island somewhere, but what is distinctive about the Caribbean voice, the Caribbean perspective, the Caribbean sense of context? What makes a story a Caribbean story to you?
I think that's a very interesting question, and a lot of people have been trying to answer. One of them, again, I'm back to geography. One of them is living in a small place. If you live in a small place, you have relatives. When my parents were alive and we sat down for dinner, people said we look like the United Nations. There was not an ethnic group not represented by an in-law or a cousin or everything. So I'm not saying everybody's living harmoniously, but we live multiculturalism. We live it, and we have to live it because we are in it. The idea of the sea, I identify so much with Irish people because of their connection to the sea. Not only that, but the connection with colonialism. Mm-hmm. And race. I'm surprised Ibrahim didn't ask me about race, because I know he's on that question. It's different. And I'm going to take a chance on this. It's always a hard thing to talk about. I think we have the same problems in the Caribbean about color that you have here, and the same kinds of discrimination and the same kind of oppression. But there's one thing I think that differentiates us. I don't think that we have ever lived in a society where someone questioned our humanity. We've never lived, of course, during slavery, yes. But another point where somebody wonders if, because you're black, you're intellectually inferior, or somehow the color of your skin, because you're black, you are a different kind of human being. I don't think, I spoke about the freedom in America, but there's also freedom I get when I'm in the Caribbean. And that is the kind of freedom where no one's questioning that about me, where I can say, I'm this, I'm doing that, and nobody's saying, oh, I mean, a black woman doing that? No one's saying, you mean you must be an exceptional black woman. Well, I'm not exceptional. I wasn't the sharpest knife in the drawer in my class, I can tell you that. But there are tons of people like me. You know, and so that, I think, so I would say the geography, and I would take a little hit at the race.
So I'm not going to let this go.
There's my niece. Doesn't she look like an Indian? She's my brother's daughter.
Well, so but exactly this question, though, in the Caribbean, skin color and the specific tone of your skin color has an outsized significance, and I think it has corollaries in this country as well, in the way people are both perceived and treated. But in your novel, even between the sisters, the three sisters, one of them is the gradations of pigmentation and skin color have an outsized significance on really every character in this novel is affected by their particular coloration. And do you see that issue, does it have an outsized significance in Caribbean life that isn't apparent here in the U.S. Is it more of a, say, black and white dynamic in this country, whereas the perception of race and color and identity, even, you know, the character of Lebanese Syrian descent who Elizabeth alluded to earlier, he is getting married to one of the three sisters, and he is accepted because he's brown-skinned. However, when the narrator, Emile, enters a relationship with Corinne, that is viewed in a different light because he is darker-skinned. So I want to stick with race for a moment now that we're here.
Well, it's the same problem here, right? The Michelle Cliff, the Jamaican writer, who is white Jamaican writer, years and years and years ago, she said the problem in the Caribbean is colorism. She defines it as colorism. And why not? There's so many, the closer you are to the people with power, the closer you look to the people with power, the more chance you get to be with the people with power. I think we're working on it. It has to do with power, and one that is really, really sad to me has to do with aesthetics. And that, my son is here, so I was going to say something about, but I remember making a concerted effort, when he was a kid to put him in front of the mirror and tell him all the time that he was handsome. I mean, deliberately. He turns out to be handsome. With much of an effort. But
at least I believed it.
All the time, and blocking some shows that I didn't want him to see. Because when I came here, I thought the most beautiful person that I wanted to be like was my mother. I thought she was just stunning. Let me be like her. She's taller than I am, and more softic than I, when she's there now, more softic than I was. But I wanted to be look like her. And then when I came to Wisconsin for the first time, I had a hard time. I couldn't not see, because in Wisconsin, you know, this is really white people in Wisconsin. Especially if you're in Fond du Lac, Wisconsin. Even one day I realized that my aesthetics had changed. I suddenly began to wonder that maybe I wasn't quite nice, that maybe my skin wasn't quite as pretty as theirs, and my hair, and my, you know, and I had to work myself out of that. So I don't know how I'm answering your question, but I'm saying the problem is here as it is there, and it's a hard problem. It's a difficult problem. Where do you get your sense of beauty when you're constantly bombarded on television and on the street, on everything, that this is what beauty is? One little thing. Do you remember that movie, The Way We Were, by Barbara Streisand, with Robert Redford? she had the same problem. She is now in Hollywood with West New Englanders, and she's worrying about her long Jewish nose and her curly hair. So she decides to go to Harlem to have her hair straightened. I just saw the movie again, that's why I'm remembering. She goes to Harlem to get her hair straightened. When she comes back, I mean, nothing's happening. It's nothing changed. She's still a Jewish girl from New York. So the movie ends with her having her hair curly and dark, you know, that's how you see her. So, you know, that movie was 1973 or something like that, and it was already questioning our sense of aesthetics. Where do we get our idea of beauty, and how does it affect you, and the struggle you have to fight against what the media is telling you is beautiful. So, you know, my granddaughter is the most beautiful little girl in the world. There's nobody more beautiful than she is. You agree, Cheryl?
I agree. I think we have time for one more question from the audience.
Yeah. Since I don't want to ruin the ending, this is more about, but I kind of, I feel like I already know what you're going to say, but your process in using King Lear as kind of a template, how did you keep all the characters in order? And that's just for any of your writing, like, and in between. I feel like there are more characters here. But, I mean, you did it so well, and each one had their own voice, you know, and the antagonists were, I mean, the sisters were just perfect.
You read it then.
I finished it.
Good for you. Good for you.
It didn't go the way I thought it was going to go in the end.
You didn't?
But
it didn't?
No, but, I mean, not in a bad way. Well, but, we'll talk about that. I like a bad ending, but it still might be a bad ending for people, but you know, anyway, it was still good, but to see how it spiraled. How did you start to spiral out with that as a template?
I don't know. I was saying to Ibrahim just before we came upstairs, I said to him, I don't know where this comes from, but when it happens, I'm just as excited about what's going on there. I mean, it's like I'm writing, but I'm also excited about it. I mean, I was standing in there, there's a scene where, you know, in King Lear, when the wicked girls start to tell him how many people Lear should have. She should have 100, and then the two girls get together and reduce it almost to nothing. Now, I knew that in my head. I had no idea where that would come in the... Yes, I agree with you. I know I wrote it, but I agree with you. And the reason I agree with you is objectively, because I don't know where it came from. But when it came, I knew it was right. I knew it was right. And so I'm writing it, and I'm having fun writing it. And I'm thinking, my God, where did it come from? Where is this? But this is it, this is it, this is it. It's following. And so, I don't know, Dr. O says, and I say this to my students, he gives the image of a car going down a dark road, and the only way the car can see in front of itself is its headlights. And the only way it can see the next part of the road is to move the car. And that's what writing is. You have to move the car, you have to write. And in your gut, you have to believe that. So with all your preparation you have, you still have to know that that when you move the car, you will see. When you do the writing, you will see. And so, yeah, so that was, I was telling Ibrahim that I was killing myself saying, oh my God, my fingers can't move fast enough.
And you laid the foundation so well for so many things in the beginning that you...
Right. You started the call.
Just set, you know, they were set back and you didn't have to bring them up. Because, I don't know why, but you remembered and then...
Well, that I have to say I also got from Shakespeare. I love the idea, which I try to tell my students, of setting out a whole bunch of strings and then you have to tie them together. They have to connect. And I read a lot about writers. You know, Virginia Woolf says that. That's her big thing. Connect, 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 connect. In fact, I was teaching a class once, and when I walked into the classroom, the students wrote on the board, connect, connect. What's that? That's what you've been saying all the time. So, you know, that whole thing. You know, for me, writing is just as you can tell, as I'm saying. I'm just dying to write another book, but it's exciting because there's that discovery, and what I hope will happen, which I hope happened to you, is that when you read it, you have that same kind of excitement and discovery.
And I do hope everyone does take the opportunity to read Elizabeth's novel. There's a moment late in the story where one of the characters is ruminating on King Lear and its positive attributes, which I'm pleased to say are also abundantly clear in Elizabeth's book, and she says, in Lear we see, what makes it so special is that we see the folly of old age, hubris, betrayal, abuse of an elderly father, adultery, madness, torture, war, murder, and all that and more in the play. In the end, Lear dead, the stage enshrouded in grief, waited with his body. And I will say there is levity too. It's a love story.
It's a love story.
It's it sounds very heavy, but it's a love. It's at heart. It's a love story.
So I give you the answer to the question when I asked you, why does Emile have partly French? Remember when Lear threw away the last daughter? I want to call her Corinne, but she's a Cordelia. I know she's Cordelia. And then, so Burgundy and France, the King of France and Burgundy are waiting. And so Burgundy, he says, well, she doesn't have anything. So Burgundy says, well, I was going to marry her if she had something, but she doesn't have nothing, so too bad, I'm gone. And the King of France says the words that I would have loved to have said to me, and all women should love to have. She says, she is herself a dowry. Like it? So of course it's in my novel. But Shakespeare said it.
So
she is herself a dowry.
On that note, Elizabeth will be signing books just on the other side of this room now. But before we retreat over there, a round of applause for Elizabeth.
And I want to recognize my publisher, the great Johnny Campbell, who is amazing. And my editor, the great Ibrahim Hamid, who looks every single line now. And my fellow writer, Vince McFarlane. Thank you.